Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the College of Architecture and Design lecture series. Before I introduce, to begin, I would like to invoke two names from urban history, Daniel Burnham from Chicago and Harlan Bartholomew, known for planning of St. Louis. Burnham, as you know, known for Chicago Plan, City Beautiful Movement, gave the phrase, make no small plans. And Bartholomew, on the other hand, was a believer in institutionalizing the process and the organization of institution of planning. And he essentially believed in making big plans, but a series of small plans. So there was the City Beautiful Movement and Bartholomew City Functional had a lot of debates and commonalities as well. But one thing they are not talked about much about is how they both believed in the idea of implementation, getting things done, action. And I believe action is the key word for Detroit today. It's a city in transformation. And a significant narrative of that transformation is Detroit Future City for the last few years. And today it will be captured to some extent by our presenter. Our presenter today is the Director of Projects of the Detroit Future City. He comes with his background in architecture and urban design from his education at Harvard as well as at the University of Kentucky. He comes with his background of practice at SOM New York as an urban designer as well as a design principal at Hamilton Anderson Associates here. He has been involved with the Detroit Future City from the time of its inception. He has built the team, procured grants to operationalize it, and spearheaded some of the initial sets of priorities and initiatives. And these initiatives are not just theoretical initiatives, but call for action on the ground. So I believe that these transformation of Detroit from its past to the future, from crisis to projects. We will learn about these in today's presentation and help me welcoming Dan Kinkead.
That was really good because I don't even think I could remember to say that about myself if I didn't have a piece of paper in front of me. Thank you, it was super cool. All right, so let me do this real quick. I think I need to do this, right? Is that, yeah, good. And then that. And then that. And that, okay. So I really am honored to be here to present to you. I really enjoy doing this. I like to share the work that we do, and gain insight from you all as I do that. We were just talking before I got up here that in some cases it seems as if the work we do in Detroit is let's just say much more appreciated outside of Detroit, and that somehow that appreciation is proportionate to the distance you are away from the city. But in any event. I might have totally messed up here because I have a mishmash of things, some things in Detroit and some other things. And in fact, what I'm trying to do tonight for you is really demonstrate how the kind of the architectural project itself, intellectual capacity and practice, is inextricably linked to the urban environment, to urbanism, to its political economy, its social constructs, all of these things. And that this isn't just something you talk about in a theory class, it's actually in practice. It may not come out that way sometimes, but it's there. And I think the work that we do as architects, urban designers, is really imbued with so many different things that we have to sometimes take a step back to kind of unpack it. And then to think about the impacts of what we do, and particularly, maybe even more important, the impacts of when we don't do something or when we aren't present. And I think there's increasingly, there's a number of things that are happening globally around cities where I think we as architects have a much bigger role to play. And I feel in some ways, in stepping into the space, we can move beyond conventional practice and move beyond, I think, what I see as a common kind of instrumentalization of our work. So that's a lot of kind of high-minded wording for, you know, what you're going to see is a pretty kind of, at the end of the day, a pretty blue-collar set of things I'm about to show you. But I think that's right. I think I'm not the most exotic character. I am you. I'm from this place. And I think we all together have something to share, not only around here, but across the globe. So it is about transcending convention. It is about making sure that we're keeping the public interest in mind. This is also kind of lost sometimes in the project. And it's about making sure that we're prepared in a way that I candidly don't think conventional practice is today to take on the multi-dimensional challenges that are gonna come toward us. And I'm gonna really lay them on you pretty heavy tonight and to hopefully then also yield where the opportunities exist. So yes, as was indicated, Detroit Future City is an initiative actually I've been part of now for about, I guess, 6 years. I started working on this as I led a team out of Hamilton Anderson Associates, my old firm. We pursued the work. I coordinated things with Tony Griffin, who led the overall project. We partnered with Dan Patera over at University of Detroit Mercy. I was really leading and managing a lot of the what was called the technical planning team, and he was leading the engagement work, and we kind of combined to create this document with Tony and a whole host of other folks around us. I think at HAA, I probably had a 10-person team at one point, and a project that was really developed with Detroiters, right, with everybody present in a really robust engagement process. And I'll talk a little bit about it. I mean, to be candid, I'm gonna talk a little bit about this, but I'm gonna talk a lot about other things and about how they relate back to this, so I hope that's cool. But the maps that you see on the side there are indicative of all the components that are woven into it. I can tell you, the individual pieces are not that innovative. This is just how cities work. But in Detroit, we kind of forgot about these things, right? Where people work and that they work in many other places than just downtown, and how they get from where they live to where they work matters, and our dependency in the car may not be so great. And, oh, we've got all this vacant land. What should we do with it? There are things that we just had not fully contemplated as we moved through from 2010 into really 2013. By 2013, we launched this work, and I was asked to start up an implementation office, and I've been there ever since, so it's going on 3 years with that implementation office, 6 years overall. I can tell you it's been, at some level, some of the most rewarding work I've ever done. It's absolutely been the most challenging, because you're in this work, you're stepping out into a very different space. It's political, it's high contact, but it's also a space in which things happen. And I think it for me defines maybe a different dimension of practice, one that may not always be associated with a building, but one that perhaps is equally important. And so we'll get into a little bit of that too. So this is our office. This is a shot of the storefront at least, and these are some numbers that you can see. Everybody likes to have some numbers. These say 74 million. These are some old numbers. I don't have the updated ones, but we try to leverage a lot of investment. We try to do a lot of projects, and we try to engage with a lot of people. And I think that for us, you know, we have operating funding from the Kresge Foundation. We work hard with a number of other foundations, as I know some of you do, to garner additional funding to implement programs. But what we try to do is really step into the breach where you see, challenges on the ground in Detroit and the opportunities that are there for the city, and sometimes they don't necessarily connect, and we try to come into that point to connect them and to really catalyze things that might not otherwise happen. We do that in a number of ways, and this is a little postage stamp thing of some of the initiatives we've done. They're different things. They're planning and pursuing EPA grants. It's coordination with the Department of Energy, economic development planning, working to bring in investors into Detroit to support groups. I mean, you recognize Veronica Scott here. I mean, a whole host of things that I'll stitch together. And they sometimes step way out of bounds for what people think we should be doing, including ourselves sometimes. But I think our team is quite earnest in trying to move the city forward, and sometimes that means you make mistakes. And I think we're learning along the way, and I feel very good about what we've been able to do. So before we go there, I'd like just to back up. And so sometimes I go to places and I present an entire slide deck that's just all Detroit Future City. And when I leave there, people think I'm a planner, which at some level I suppose is okay. But I think that that distinction is troublesome for me, because I think that as architects, we again have become somewhat kind of set aside, right? And we're kind of procured for a very specific technical task, right? And that technical task is becoming increasingly specialized. And I think it puts us in a position to have far less agency around the key issues that are impacting our lives and are impacting our cities. And I then am advocating for, and I want to demonstrate in this presentation, perhaps not the most robust intellectual project, but one that is highly discursive and one that moves across a number of different terrains and boundaries, right? That you don't have to ask for permission to step into a space that you normally wouldn't be in, you just go there. And so some of the stuff I'm gonna show you is just to illustrate my background, which is, as an architect, is doing buildings. So this was a building I did actually right in the construction was completed right during the midpoint of Detroit Future City. So these two things going simultaneously. For me, that was exhilarating. That's what I absolutely love to do, to have these very different things happening at one time. I think for a lot of people it's very troubling because they don't know what to make of you. And I find that fun. So the project is quite, none of these are intended to knock you down, but the idea is, look, we went through this process to do this building for Michigan State. It's a linguistics building for them. It was there to redefine a place called Wells Hall, which is a kind of Eastern Bloc looking building along Shaw Lane that was the front door to the university facing the stadium. And that they really wanted to reposition it and introduce the university people as they came through. And so we had a whole host of different ways we approached it. We ended up doing something that the leadership wanted, which was essentially placing three additional floors across a series of lecture halls like these at a 31 degree angle, because it would be perpendicular to the northernmost building for the leadership. That was important, and we understood that. This is after about a year of figuring out exactly where all this stuff goes. It also preserved People's Park toward the east along the Red Cedar River. When we did that, that meant that this massive building, and there's about 88,000 square feet above the lecture halls, to support it, we had to come up with an innovative structural system, because you couldn't put any columns in a sight line. So imagine that size building running across a building full of these rooms and not being able to block any of your views. And so this was a really, really huge challenge. We ended up developing a different brace frame system to do this. But the point I'm making here is not so much about how awesome the braced frame system was, but the fact that you can do that and you can help plan a city at the same time. There are ways to do this, and I think that when you bring these things together, some pretty cool things can happen. So this is part of that frame foot, maybe in the earlier third of Detroit Future City. These are some of the spaces that came out of it. Looking out, this space looks directly out onto Shaw Lane in a pretty cool way. This is the underside of it. There's a stadium. That's the front there, and then some interior spaces you can see. Anyway, the shots themselves aren't important, but really the idea of it. The idea with this building also was a radical departure from the way the university had done their faculty offices in the past. It was all open seating because they were dealing with some really tough numbers in how to manage space. And we were shifting people. This was a kind of like the last domino of a 25 set domino run across the university to move programming around. And this was the terminus point that allowed all those other things to happen. And so it meant that we were bringing faculty into the space, and I can tell you many, many were very, very frustrated the fact they wouldn't have a private office anymore. And we went through meetings when we bring people in here, and we'd actually bring them in and show them how they actually have, when these shades go up and down with the sun, and when you look out, you see all over the Red Cedar River. And immediately when people saw that, they realized that, whoa, this is incredible. Not only do I get to see outside of the river, but I can turn around and I can talk to my coworkers quite easily in it. And what we're understanding now from post-occupancy studies is that the kind of communal atmosphere in here is pretty contagious, and they want to do more of this across the university. So those are the shades down. I think part of the work that I've done too is also just kind of right on the ground, kind of bare knuckle stuff. This is in a city, unfortunately, that has a lot more notoriety these days, Flint. And this was a project I did a few years before the one I just showed you, and it was working with the local mass transit provider that actually has some of the highest ridership in Southeast Michigan as a percentage of population, much higher than DDOT. This was their space. This was their downtown bus terminal. This is the place that many, many folks in Genesee County, in Flint, this is what they use to get around. This environment, this huge concrete frontage with this inhospitable entry point to a little kind of like gas station shop. We worked with the group to really re-envision the whole thing. The idea was that we have to celebrate this kind of public infrastructure. This is in the heart of downtown. It could actually be a huge progenitor for new investment, not seen as like, oh, the old bus terminal. Man, okay, we can't go there. What could it be? And so what we did was we completely stripped it down, taking away all those opaque surfaces, and opened it up with tons of glass. And so we raised it up. It has this really kind of, the top of it is like this, once you strip all it away, it has this kind of Mesian kind of plinth to it, just floats. These really slender columns that run along, and they zigzag in and out for the bus, because there's a sawtooth every time the buses come in, right? They park in a sawtooth fashion either side. And we just blew out all the walls and put glass in, cleaned it up, and we did it really quite inexpensively. I think we came in slightly under budget. And I felt really good about this project because it was one that I felt had some strong design components in it with a really limited budget, and it celebrated something that a lot of people quite honestly just try to hide, and it made it worthy of going to, and so families could be there and you could walk and you could feel safe. Times before, I don't think that many folks could. So this is all the light that's let in. I don't have a before shot for you, but it was quite a bit darker, and you couldn't see out that other end either, right? So that kind of blows out, and you actually see the historic facades across the street there. You know, and working with the client around these circulation studies, probably at a degree which I didn't need to do for bus terminal, to be honest, but it got them excited about how they could reappropriate this space that was for offices into this new Rosa Parks little museum space, and how the common patron could come in and tour it very quickly and come out and go catch a bus, so it wasn't something that people would get stuck in. And that was a neat exercise too, to get them fired up about it. There's other things that I've done too along the way, working a lot with DTE over a number of years, some buildings actually saving. This building right here, this is the Salvation Army building on Bagley, if you're familiar with that one. Really feel good about this one as well. The office I left, Hamilton Anderson, ended up doing that work, and it was great to save it, and it actually frames a big part of that part of downtown, which needs a great deal of framing. I've also worked on other kind of conventional urban design things, helping people understand how they can reinvest in their own areas. This is Children's Center in Midtown, so a part of the city that's going through really big transformations. At the time we did this, there was a real struggle to actually just get people here for fear of a number of things, including their own safety. But now there's huge struggles because the economy's pivoting, spaces are getting more costly, and a whole host of things. And we were working with them to identify ways in which they could use some of the land that they own actually as revenue generation that could support their programs, which are really, really important programs for youth across the city, really across all of Wayne County. And I think along the way, we've done a number of other things. This is some work I did with Palabic, and I show this slide. I don't actually show any of the design work because, to me, these program diagrams, these are things that I do when I get into projects. When we come in, the way that I always approach it is at a very evidence-based level. So we would analyze all, this is true of all the projects you've seen so far, but this is an illustration here. We work with Puabic, who has very, you know, if you're familiar with Puabic pottery in Detroit, I'm sure many of you are, it's a very tiny historic space, very cool, but very difficult to have multiple programs in at one time. And what we did was these studies to figure out what the ebb and flow was of different programs over time and how to position these things differently so that the expansion that they were imagining could be actually much smaller than it was. You could preserve the identity of it, and you could create much more refined, intimate spaces that are really the kind of feel of what that place was. And that led to some interesting work down the road with them too. There are other things along the way that stretch outside. So around the same time I was doing some competition work with the World Bank. This was actually to land a new Supreme Court, Cassation Court in Armenia. So these are some of the former Soviet republics. This is in the Caucasus region. There are many of these that were kind of opening up, and they didn't have the basic infrastructure in place. When we saw this come through, we went after it, and I was really excited because to me this is also the real role of architecture, right? The way to kind of step into an environment, clearly an urban space in Yerevan, one that has suffered mightily from an oppressive regime over a very long period of time, and where the actual core judicial infrastructure was not present. And in fact, when we put all this work together, and we did this within 2 weeks, you guys know Claudia Wigger, right? Do you know her? Anyway, so there's a woman that we hired in the brink of this project. She was about 8 months pregnant. And we worked on this for 2 weeks, and she stayed with me until midnight every single night, working until her husband pulled her away, because we both felt so passionate about this project. And we got it out, we landed on the ground, we had a partner on the ground in Yerevan. They took it over to the local emissary that was gonna do the processing. We got the call the next day, they said, man, we just missed a deadline, I can't believe it. You know, and I'm like, I really can't believe it. I'm gonna jump through the phone and get you over there. And what we realized later was nobody missed a deadline. This is just the way you do business. You guys don't do our business. And so it got shut down right there. And we actually tried to intervene through Washington, D.C., but couldn't. And it was a huge lesson for me in the kind of geopolitical state and how you actually have to kind of work through that. And I will never forget it, but hopefully we'll not have to experience that again. Anyway, this project did not go forward, or at least for us. So this was another one that I did, though. This is actually before I got back to Detroit. This was when I was in New York working at SOM. This is a shot of Columbia University. It's generally in the kind of foreground here. Most folks know this university. This is the site of their main campus. They around the, I guess this is around like 2002, 2003, and 2004. Their new president Lee Bollinger from University of Michigan was there, was recognizing that they were the school with the least amount of total gross square footage per student for all the Ivy League schools, and that they were really suffering. They had a premium on their space, they couldn't expand into different programs, and they really were missing huge, what they call indirect cost recoverables for research facilities. They couldn't put them in here. You can just look, I show this image because you can just tell, you're not gonna fit a lot in here, and you're certainly not gonna fit it in at a lower cost. So what we did was, my group and SOM and Renzo Piano Building Workshop joined together, pursued a project, and ended up working with these guys to set up an expansion into West Harlem, so right up Broadway, which you're actually seeing right here, this piece. So they're at 116th. This goes up then to 125th, up to 133rd along this corridor. Very different worlds. Columbia has a very contested relationship with the community, particularly up to the north, as you get in deeper into Harlem, particularly West Harlem. And this is another really big point I want to make, that this is a space that architects can and should step into. It's not that the planners and the politicians and others kind of step up and figure this stuff out and then kind of pass you the next thing along. Because when they do that sometimes, I think a lot of huge opportunities are lost in the design process. I think we have to actually step into this space. And this is a space, this is really one of my first really big lessons in hardcore public public engagement, and it taught me some really big lessons that I took with me back to Detroit. And really learned, I really learned a lot here also about social and racial equity and how important these things matter. And it's something I practice every single day in Detroit, and something honestly we all must do as architects for a number of reasons. So as we went forward, we developed a number of different schemes and had this really robust engagement process. And we're expanding. This is the one of the main models for it at one time. So what had existed here before was kind of nothing. It was a bunch of chop shops and illegal auto repair and like some old slaughterhouses. If you're familiar with the area, the Fairway Market is right up around the corner here, which is a great grocery store along the Hudson. It was a kind of really crappy property. It was depressed, literally down. Very close to the waterline, the Hudson. It was surrounded by all of these viaducts and these trains. You have the 1 and 2 line here, Metro North line, the 12th Avenue viaduct, and Riverside. So if you're like Law and Order, if there's any like murder scene or something like that, you're usually shot under this viaduct. It's a really interesting place. And your teeth want to rattle out of your head when you're walking because the train, when the 1 and 2 comes up here, because the ground goes down, it's the one, so it's a subway, right? It comes out of the ground right about here. It'll literally like shake you to death. And what was interesting is this site was identified because it had available space. And again, we wanted to put science labs here for research facilities. These research facilities ended up having requirements about like so many microns of movement per second that we had to isolate. And this thing wants to knock you down when you're just walking. And it was an incredible challenge technically and politically. And the technical dimension of it got even deeper because we were trying to figure out how to deal with that shaking. But also what we realized was that we ended up finding basically a millennial fissure in northern Manhattan. So what happens is toward the north, where am I looking? Well, I guess it's up this way. There's rock outcroppings, right? And you actually, they built homes up on the rock, like they climb up. And then you go down to the south, it happens again. You go up to like Grant's Tomb and Riverside Park and all that stuff. So if you're familiar, there's like these big things. This all dips down. What we found was this isn't just this kind of like little dip. There's like nothing down there. There's just kind of fill over time. And we did soil borings, and from like plus 20 above grade, down to, zero, negative 20, it went down to 200 and we couldn't bore anymore and they fell off. So it meant that now we not only had this technical problem with the shaking, but we also didn't have a foundation. We didn't have bedrock to unlock down to. And that's why you have in lower Manhattan and midtown Manhattan, that's why the buildings are taller. It wasn't just somebody decided to build tall buildings there. That's actually where the bedrock is closest to the surface. It's cheaper. Here, it was very expensive. Very, very expensive. And so this process really kind of taught me a lot about how you integrate really intricate systems. And we took a lot of time. These are models that I built, figuring out how these systems could flow through these lab buildings and how they could actually connect to a bigger system overall. And worked on a lot of this with Renzo's team. We were back and forth between Paris and New York every other week, which sounds super awesome and exotic, but it is really rough when you're loading a 747 at 6 o'clock in the morning in Charles de Gaulle to come back to present later that day. And you just do that again and again. But that project went forward, and in the end, I mean, some of the things that came out were just really amazing. And I think the way that Columbia was able to foster a relationship with the community in the past it hadn't, to me, was quite rewarding. So there's other things that I've done here that I think are indicative of someone working who's also kind of struggling to find their way. Of course, I did a number of large-scale projects with SOM in China, as anyone would imagine one would do. Over time, they're huge. I didn't deal with anything that was less than 1 billion square feet. I don't know they're entirely the most responsible things to be working on. And I think I look back on that time they were exciting for sure, and we were testing some pretty interesting things. This was some stuff we were doing, some active LED skins that also had photovoltaics in them that could generate power to actually run the skins at night, which is super cool. This is out in this one is around the Third Ring Road, northwest side of Beijing. Some interesting things were happening in this project, but I show it just to say these are some of the things we do that sometimes maybe, we'd like to do things a little bit different in the future. So another end of the work that I've done, it's kind of starts to lead more into the work that I do on the ground in Detroit right now, was start a group in HAA called Rogue HAA. We had started an internal design kind of group to kind of gin up the whole design ideas within there. Melissa Dittmer and a handful of others really kind of worked with me on this, and Melissa really moved Rogue HAA forward and externalized it. And we did a lot of kind of research in the city early on in a way that other people really weren't at the time, certainly through conventional practice. And we would do this stuff at night and write all these things and put them out on the blog and run events like this, where this one's one I led with all the local leads for the national philanthropic entities and understanding what they were doing in the city and a whole host of other things. We had a number of different events, some really cool installations along the way. And I think this is also part of architectural practice. This is something that a lot of people don't get to. It's a beast because you got billable work, you got all these other things you got to do, but these things end up being not only the most rewarding things, but I think the things that from which I learned the most, and have certainly informed the way that I approach my work now. There's other things that we got into over time that I've gotten into, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about this later, but this is a large scale design competition that we coordinated with another group out of New York for the Packard plant. This has actually ended up leading to a lot of interesting design research on adaptive reuse for industrial buildings, and I'm really excited about this work, and look forward to sharing a little more with you. And I think this is another thing that I've really had the opportunity to do in the last like 2 years that I think is also important for us as architects, to be present in conversations that we're typically not, to be talking at a policy conference around the relationship between design and race, to talk a little bit about how we design cities better, recognizing the precarious position our country is from its infrastructure perspective. And this conversation at Brookings was just on that, understanding how we work together with policy leaders and engineers to completely restructure the infrastructure that we have. Because just before this, when we were up here on stage, there was the senior House member from Maryland was up, and he was talking about a lot of the foreign direct investment, but also all the American firms holding their capital offshore, so we can't draw the taxes off of it. And that very day, it was amazing. It was pouring rain in D.C., and I made the point that without the ability to come in with new investment to separate these systems, the combined sewer systems that we have, all of that stuff is going to rush through, and it goes out in their tidal basin, in the Potomac and other places. In Detroit, it's the same thing here too. When you get a little bit more than a half an inch of rain in less than an hour, all combined, and it surges through our system, takes all the raw human waste with it, typically unprocessed at that point, and gets pushed out into, in our case, the Detroit River. Now, the difference is, here in D.C., they're going out in the Potomac and out ultimately into a number of other areas that go out into the ocean. Here, we're at the center of 84% of the North American fresh surface water supply, 22% of the global fresh surface water supply. And so I felt like when we were there that I was trying to express to them that we need action now in places like Detroit. And so part of taking that action when you don't get big money from DC is going out with people with a bunch of shovels to actually plant trees, to incorporate green infrastructure, and to clean the air for neighborhoods that otherwise wouldn't have it. And that's what you see on the lower right. All this stuff is stuff that we need to be doing, right? It's not part of your professional practice course, and it's not part of what you're gonna honestly hear from groups like the AIA a lot, but I think a lot of that's changing, and I think there's opportunities for us to really step in there. I think also we need to be much more conscious about what's happening globally and what's happening globally in urban areas. And I've been doing some consulting work with the World Bank recently on some of the work they're doing in studying urbanized areas globally and what they can do to help stabilize them. Think what you will about the World Bank, but they do have an interest in the global economic system. Usually many might cynically say, yeah, that's to support the Western hegemony of the global economy, but if you set that aside one moment, they also, for that to work, everyone has to have opportunity globally. in what we're recognizing in the work that we've done with them. And really our work, the group I led, was really about the graphic kind of development of all the information they were bringing together so they could convey it to the leaders on the ground in these places and then back into the U.S. as well. What we were understanding is that there are real challenges coming. You have areas that are rapidly urbanizing. So in Detroit, we talk about these huge challenges. The city's emptying people out, right? Depopulating, disinvestment, all of these things. But in other parts of the world, places like China or toward the Pacific Rim, or particularly South Asia, there's rapid urbanization with very limited resources, and the numbers that we're seeing there are really quite stark, and they don't bode well for us globally, and they really indicate that millions upon millions of people are going to be suffering. They're suffering today, and they'll suffer in the future, and we have to figure out how to deal with this, right? So at one level, working on this with the World Bank to figure out what to do and really how to express this to leaders on the ground in, say, you know, China or wherever. But the reality for me that I look at it is understanding how do we as architects and designers figure out our role in this, right? Because it's not considered in the World Bank's work. Where do we step in here? What can we do to help in a way that we're not? We think about how important these areas are and how they do make up really the dominant part of our global economy. We can't really afford to have them fail. This is extended into some work to be done now in South Asia. This is our most recent work, and doing these kind of documents they can get to people on the ground when they host events, but then also how they can do these quick releases of information so people get a snapshot of what's happening very fast to understand what the challenges are. This also helps them coordinate with other kind of global partners. And in this work, you know, we're just, you know, what we're realizing is that as these areas grow, and this shot is the way we compose this is purposeful, right? Is that as these areas grow, they're getting choked off very quickly. So you're seeing this rapid surge, particularly in South Asia, but the infrastructure isn't present to actually move it forward. And so all of a sudden you hit a real limit, right? The transportation systems aren't there for people to get to work. The childcare systems to support the families aren't there. And you really start to struggle all the way down to just even how you develop agglomerating economies and how you get people to work, right? I mean, this shot from Bangladesh, this is how a lot of people are getting to work. This it's not right, right? It's not safe. But this is today. Right? So what's next year and what's the year after that as this population essentially mushrooms? It's not going to work. You're going to have real calamity here. And that calamity is going to come back to us in a lot of ways. And quite honestly, even if it doesn't, it's still our obligation to do what we can to help. There's some other work that we've been doing with them, some preliminary stuff in Africa. This stuff has stopped, but I'll let you read these stats up here. These are also startling, right? And so when I look at it, I'm again helping them with these packages, but I'm also just taken aback by this. What can we do as architects, as designers, to help step in here? Because clearly this isn't just about providing money, right? It's not just about making sure programs are in place. This is about physical infrastructure. It's about the spaces in which people interact and how their economies function. And so for me, that's led me to do some other things, including some deeper writing, and this is something that's gonna come out, I think, in about a month. I was a chapter contributor to this Remaking Post-Industrial Cities. This is a book that essentially situates North American post-industrial recovery against European post-industrial recovery. And I think the lessons that come out of this are really quite powerful, and they actually relate back to some of that World Bank stuff. And I just think, as architects, we need to be in this world too. It's not just about doing a building or doing an interior, but it's about really stretching and contributing to this kind of dialogue. So clearly, this is about transcending convention. It's about moving beyond those kind of barriers. I think it's important not just to do those things for the kind of merit that I'm laying out, but also because of, in a normal, I call this the chain. This is the chain of, I'll let you read it, but this is the chain from top to bottom of decision-making generally that you see in a project, right? All the way down, there's a process that goes, there's maybe a market thing, regulatory change, whatever happens, board of directors meets, they tell the CEO what they want, committee happens, the real estate deal gets cut, yep, all the way down, right? They go out, they actually RFQ for a master plan, do the master plan, and then maybe a couple years later, there's a capital plan that's developed, then they get some financing in place, they get a project team, they get build up everything else, do an RFQ, then do an RFP, and then there you are, right there. And so much has happened up here already, right? So the opportunity to have intervened at some level is no longer there. You are at the tip of a spear that forces you, I think, to some degree to be instrumentalized. In some cases, that may be okay. That's what we do. But in other cases, I think we really need to find a way to get back up there, right? And I think the way that we get back up there is through some of the stuff that I've shown you. I don't claim that it's everything, but I feel that it's some way to get there, and it's not through some kind of big takeover, but rather through the merit of the work. And as we do it, when we get back up there, we do it in concert with the public, right? With stakeholders, with the people for whom this work, whatever it might be, matters most. It's not just about us in a kind of autocratic step to take action, but understanding what the public's looking for, what users are looking for, what these guys over here may be missing, right? We can be that kind of linkage. We can challenge folks. We can bring with us research, advocacy, all of this kind of insight, and quite honestly, to do it, we have to take risk. And this is a point that I think is really tough for a lot of folks to deal with, particularly when you get into professional practice. How do you define that point? Where do you take risk, and how much of it? I don't know the answer. Everybody's gonna be a little bit different, but I think we need to step in there a little bit more than we may be today. So the big idea here, though, is that to do these things, I think, gets us in a better position to deal with these challenges that are coming at us. And they're a little bit more than even what I just laid out. These are challenges, and I think they also yield opportunities. They better yield opportunities, or better just forget about it, because they're huge, like the storm, which was Katrina. And I think after Katrina hit, there was a moment where there was an insertion of architecture, right, of thinking about design, about space, and about, you know, urban economy and race and all of it together at the same time, which was really, really important. Brad Pitt was there, and you know, some stuff happened. We designed some stuff down there and did some competitions. But at the end of the day, you know, how much changed, right? I think that's questionable. And where, what happened overall from a kind of social economic perspective, what do we do going forward? And it seems like these things are happening more and more often, right? So where are we in this? Where are we here in Ferguson, right? Where are we both at the front end, and where are we at the back end? You know, is there a role here? Is there a way for us to be a participant in a new kind of civic exchange that we have to have, that's going to impact all of us? And we have to understand that for some of us, like myself, we come from a position of privilege. I come from a position of white privilege that I can't possibly comprehend. And I think we all, at some level, no matter where we're from, have to kind of understand our position here and understand what that means. And the work that I've done with Detroit Future City has taught me that time and time again, and we have to understand it. This isn't necessarily part of practice, it's part of the way we think. And it's about empathy, right? And it's about understanding that some things are not okay, right? Because, you know, if your kid was living here, no, it wouldn't be okay. And how do we start to work toward these things, knowing we don't have all the money in the world, but we do have some expertise to get there? And at the end of the day, we're all connected, right? This is this global connected flight map. It's a very small world. It's a very, very small world. And somehow we have to feel a sense of immediacy, I think, in understanding how we step into these issues globally, as just as we would dealing with highly localized issues. And it's more than just hunkering down, right? And there's a beautiful project, but this is the seed bank in Norway. You know, it's more than this, though, right? It's not to say, okay, it's right, doomsday is coming, let's set all the seeds aside. We've already withdrawn this from here, right? The first withdrawal was made for Syria. We've got to go beyond this, right? You don't just kind of come back. And as we do it, so brace yourselves here. I'll let you read some of these. Hopefully you can read them. We have to realize that we're at a moment where things are radically changing, and they're changing fast, and they're not changing for the better. And we've got to find a way to get in here. The information I'm going to share you is cultivated and pulled together by a group called Metabolic out of Amsterdam that we've been doing some partnerships with. And they kind of speak for themselves. They call them hockey stick diagrams. These are essentially these kind of high-end exponent curves that demonstrate these kind of arguably irrevocable trends that we're tracking. Population, some of them are not all bad, but they're there. Total real GDP, CO2 concentration, ozone, foreign direct investment, depending on how you stand, that could either be good or bad, but river damming, temperature rise, flooding, our water use overall, our fertilizer consumption. This gets back to some real nitrogen issues as well, the ocean ecosystems and the fisheries being taken over, paper consumption, the use of motor vehicle rise. You can see these are relatively recent kind of swings up. Loss of rainforest and woodlands. And then this one is, I think actually this goes back to the seed bank, but this one's probably one of the scariest ones, the decline in biodiversity. And I think we're seeing things happen at a really, really sharp rate right now, where you know our kids are not gonna have the thing, literally the things that we've had, everyone else has had as we've existed here as people. That may not be good, right? Because we need things. We don't know what we need until we actually use them, right? When we actually develop penicillin, we forgot what we needed. So where are we in this, right? And I'm not saying we as architects bear all this, but how do we find some agency in this to think about a different position to these kinds of challenges? Because it's gonna require all of us. So as we see those growth rates, I'm doing this, believe it or not, this is like the nice slide. This is saying it's, yes, it's shooting up, but if you look at it, if you spread out the time like that a little bit and you realize that while it's still rising, we're also declining in the actual growth rate. So population's climbing, but growth rate is going down, particularly across the West. But we need to think about this broadly, that the population's still gonna go. And at the same time, we are seeing exponential growth in urban areas. In some cases, in the work that I've studied in through the World Bank, is that these are also areas that also become like part of an urbanized area. They just claim it, right? When you expand just outside of Calcutta, it's not sprawl, it's an urbanized area, right, all of a sudden. So that's changing, but the land area is at a fraction of the pace compared to the population. So this is real, but it may not be the huge challenge that it is. It may be a huge opportunity, because cities have some pretty awesome characteristics, right? And those cities that actually have greater urban density of people per area, right, actually start to perform a little bit better. And of course, here's where we are. So this is about vehicle miles traveled through private transportation. We are the baby blue in the West, particularly the United States. I couldn't actually lock in Detroit on this one, but see it come down, Canada into Europe, into North Africa, into Asia, and so forth, into the Pacific Rim. And what a lot of folks are trying to do is find that kind of balance point and where we need to be, what's truly sustainable. And the fact that the urbanized areas are growing so fast, we think this is the place to do this. How do we then step in as architects and designers and work with planners and others and politicians to figure out how we get this moving along a little bit more quickly than we are? Because all that stuff I shared with you, as I'm talking, it's still, those hockey stick diagrams are still shooting up, right? And so how do we step in here? It goes beyond, you know, this is, you look at that slide and think about the thing I showed you about Michigan State University. You know, I at some level, I actually start to question the relevance of that stuff. This is the place where we need to be. And as we do it, when we think about, as I say, hey, more cities, more urbanized areas, higher density, yeah, this is good. At the same time, we also have to realize that there are real challenges here, because there are huge wealth disparities in our country. There's huge wealth disparities globally, certainly. But we also have to understand that as we think more about an urbanized area, you think about concentrations of wealth, you think about concentrations of poverty. How do we work together to actually eradicate those things, right? And what are the ways in which design can actually mediate in a space that sometimes the political dimension really struggles? So therefore, I think that cities are the place to act. These are some stats, again, that were pulled together by our partners at Metabolic, which I think are really important. So cities today are 3% of our global land area. They produce 80% of our global GDP. They're responsible for 90% of the innovation we track. They produce 50% of the global waste. and they consume 70% of the natural resources and account for 80% of our global greenhouse gas production. These are places for a huge positive intervention, but they're also a place to really begin to mitigate some of the negative externalities, right? Because if you can get in here, the 1 square mile, let's say, of area you can cover may have a much more profound impact than the 1 square mile you cover somewhere else. So if you're pressed for time, which I would argue we are, and you're pressed for money, which I would say we are as well, maybe these are the spaces that we really need to be focusing in on. Maybe these are the places that we need to draw a lot more attention to. And I think these are also incredibly dazzling spaces, right? These are places that we kind of dream about, and sometimes the dreams come true. There's places of commerce and activity, right? Art, this is a place for invention every single day, as some of the folks in our audience know quite well. These are also spaces to take things back, right? This is actually part of the Occupy movement. This is so cool. I think this is a great, this is like, what can architecture do? I mean, this is Brasilia, right, with Neumeier. And I mean, look at the space. That stage, right, their moment was amplified because of that space being there. It's just, these are the places where things happen. This is actually Washington Square Park, another Occupy thing. And they're also the spaces where we can rethink urbanity, right? Where this is in Chicago. And these are spaces where maybe the urban kind of paradigm we had in the past is not exactly what we have going forward. Maybe we can incorporate open space to mitigate some of the stormwater I talked about, but also to feed populations that might otherwise not have access to fresh food. So in that space is where we tend to operate for Detroit Future City. I'm not telling you we have, like, all of a sudden we have all the answers, but we try really, really hard. We get our heads beat in regularly as we do it, but we keep going. And we have some people that really, really love us along the way. And again, you know, you, at least from what I can tell, you only live once. If you're going to do it, go for it. You don't know how long it's going to last, and see what you can do. So for us, our current focus is around resilience, reutilizing spaces and things and whatnot, and then essentially transforming the city for the better. We got a 9-person team. We work in partnerships and we advocate for a lot of stuff. We do a lot of catalytic activity, and we try to be thought leaders to really change people's thinking. So these are some of the things we're working on right now. That reading them is not terribly important, but you have to show a Venn diagram every once in a while. So we tend to focus in certain areas, so there's a spatial reality to this, to how you do this. It's not just, I don't know, everywhere, right? It means if we're going to focus growth in a city like Detroit, where do we make it count? Where does it support the systems that are so expensive, that are going to drive our economy, that are going to get more Detroiters employed? Because today, for every 4 Detroiters, we only have 1 private sector job. Most American cities, like an even-handed city like Philadelphia, is about 2.5 to 1. We are way out of bounds. And so if we're going to be a contributor on that global scale, right, we've got to get more folks employed. We've got to get folks access to health amenities and services, activate our corridors. It's not everywhere. You can't start everywhere. But where do you start to really build up? And how do you have small scale efforts across the city overall? How do you do that to anchor major areas that need some stability, the areas that pay the vast majority of the property tax that supports the city of Detroit, that expands out into residential neighborhoods at medium degrees of density and vacancy, 30% land vacancy in these areas. But these areas I'm lighting up in the map also have the highest concentrations of kids and elderly. So you've got vulnerable populations here. And then how do you understand in those areas that have really high degrees of land vacancy, you know people are going to live there in perpetuity, but we have to think about different types of land uses in the ground. What do you incorporate? We think there can be big open space systems that can do things really, really differently, and it can improve things on the ground. All of that comes together to deliver something that we think is a unique value proposition, to have dense nodes of density, to live a kind of urbanized life, to have access to open space. Open space, by the way, that we show as a percentage of the total area of the city, which is just smaller than the total open space that the city of New York holds across all 5 boroughs. Sometimes we show that map, people are like, oh my, no way, you know, we can't, no city can function with all that open land. They can. And in the case of New York, of course, they have a robust economy to support it. All those spaces cost them money. In this case, some of the spaces we show will actually generate revenue. They'll generate jobs as well. So these things can all be woven in together. And by the way, you see those green little lines, those are buffering us from the the industrial spaces because we have the space to do it, and our kids have 3 times the rate of childhood asthma than the national average, so we might want to do it. So the public interest is a big, big part of this. I'm going to click through those 3 projects I highlighted before. So HUD Resilience, in August of 2014, if you recall, if your car was not floating somewhere, many of my neighbors' cars were floating, we had all this happen, which I'll let you read. Really bad stuff. It's going to happen again. And it may happen again and again and again. If you saw the hockey stick diagram, right, there's an exponent function here. Things are changing. How do we get prepared for it? How do we do that when we know we don't have $5 billion in money laying around to dump into huge concrete infrastructure systems? And by the way, when we also know we have all this vacant land in and around Detroit, how do we deal with this and make sure we can actually preserve people's quality of life? So this isn't New Orleans, this is us. I think this is like Warren or something. This is us on some day in August. Could be next August again. How do we take those open spaces we have to begin to mitigate things like this and to save this kind of stuff from happening and the deep impact on the city? And so for us, one of the things we've worked on in the course of really 2015 with one guy on our team, Chris Dorley, really drove this work, working hand in hand with the city, we helped to define a resilience program, a package that we could share with the U.S. U.S. Department of, HUD, excuse me, with the U.S. Housing and Urban Development Department to garner $8.9 million in community development block grant money. This was discretionary funds because we didn't actually qualify for the presidentially declared emergency, which is kind of like bonus money in a way. And we were able to do this in partnership to bring this money in to really think differently about how we run these systems in the future. To help clean up people's basements, to think about renewable energy, think about a host of things that we're not typically able to do. These are things that we do at Detroit Future City. Again, it's not your conventional practice, but I think it's important that we contribute in a way that can help move this stuff forward. So a very basic design that you guys know for managing stormwater, that could be incorporated, and it's part of the process. Part of it also links to our open space network. So this is a nice way of describing that. Right, and this that you see is an average shot of the kind of inner portion of the city. This area happens to be suffering from about 65 to 70% overall land vacancy. And at a certain level, you could say, well, this is fine. It is, but everything that's there still costs all the money that it ever did, right? All the police runs, the fire runs, the water, the power, the sewer, so forth, right? And in many cases, we're paying into that big time and we're not getting the kind of services in the back end that we need. So how do we begin to re-envision these spaces and make them work for us? This is about 23.5 square miles today. We do this in a number of ways to get at this issue through research, activating programs, thinking about these things from a recreational side to productive and ecological ends. We see the vacant land in the city actually exponentially growing because as we're working hard to eliminate blight in the city, this is a big effort for the mayor, which is important. Living next to blight is not good. Depending on how you want to call it, it's still an issue. How do you begin to actually remove that? When you do remove it, you'll actually end up with about 30 square miles of vacant land. If I didn't mention, this is a little bit larger than the island of Manhattan. At the same time, we're trying to figure out how we can work with partners like MISHTA and CCP to begin to advance certain programs on the ground. And I know right now the city is looking closely at these types of things as well. So for us, it's about improving quality of life, systems, food, energy, all of this stuff together working. It happens in a big kind of crazy scale and big policy documents, things that we work on with the Center for Community Progress. Darrell Byrne is leading a lot of this work for us. These are the nuts and bolts and really high level thinking you need to get it done, to understand how all of that, which is all the vacant land, can turn into that and actually sustain the city and stabilize it, provide jobs and recreation and actually clean our air and likely reduce our heat island effect considerably. One of the ways we think we can get there is actually through a really hands-on tactical tool, and this is something that's really been developed by Aaron Kelly on our team, And there's a host of folks with her that are actually working to implement it. This is a field guide for working with lots. And basically, it's a hands-on guide that for Detroiters to use as we try to understand what we can do with the vacant property around us, particularly the vacant side lot that we might own or might have just picked up from the Detroit Land Bank Authority. What do you do with it? Because you pick it up, that's great. Okay, what's next? And so this guide really steps in, and the way that we developed it was so that you could use it with your neighbors to actually develop the concept together, procure the services, or work on it yourself. These are not the usual workers there walking, as you can tell, but figure out, you know, how to actually do something on the ground. Using, again, the work that I've shown you so far in the field guide, laying out the 34 different lot designs that we developed. These are also done with a host of other folks that helped us out, the work department, Hamilton Anderson Associates, a fleet of folks that made this happen. We don't do these things by ourselves. A website that was developed also, so you can gain access here to figure out what you need to do. All of it tells you how much it might cost, how long, the expertise you need, et cetera. And then we can also step in to provide technical assistance. So this is the guide itself and what it lays out. You know, this idea around discover your lot, what could it be? It really builds on the framework, and then this kind of hands-on thing, how you sketch on the document, something for us and then maybe design world we take for granted, but for an average Detroiter, they're not usually thinking in these spatial ways, right? And so it was really interesting to go in and figure out how have people understand, you know, where the sun is and where the wind comes, and when in the morning, where, you know, where's the shadow and things like that. But we're really excited about it. And some of the pilot projects we ran last fall started up. These are some shots from community members coming together. In this case, it's Black Family Development working in the Osborne neighborhood in the northeast side, coming and cleaning up a lot, getting it prepared, and then actually leaving the work behind. And it just demonstrates what's possible at a really grassroots level when people are given the opportunity to do something like this, and we were really excited about this process, and it's moving forward. We just launched our mini grant program. We have got I think 15 groups that were awarded. Those projects will be moving forward in the spring. So as we do that, though, we know that we have to begin to think about this innovative future. We got to figure out how we can actually coordinate all this stuff together, form this network, and make sure that people are understanding the value proposition overall to open space. To have open space is not to say we're not growing the city. It's important that we grow the city, but it's also important that as we do it, we really increase density, and I think that's the key thing, and as we do that, also stabilize neighborhoods. By the way, this is a solar strand in Buffalo by Walter Hood. It's a beautiful power and art project woven across the University of Buffalo, which we think is high relevance to Detroit. Another project we're doing right now, this Ideas for Innovation and Participation, is big. It's a six-part series that we actually just wrapped up. For us, our role in design and so forth is not just about laying out all these designs and talking to people about the technical content, but it is very much about the engagement. It's about civic participation. It's a core of what we do. And this is a shot from one event we hosted at Gleaners. Midway through the series. This was actually on open space. You get people coming through, talking about what they can do with their lots. Actually, this is Andrea in Osborne. She's talking about the work that they're doing there that ended up leading to those lots. They're actually sharing food that was grown in the city on vacant property. And then you have folks both from within the city government, folks running other nonprofits related to environmental justice and open space, talking about what they think is possible there. And you have Detroiters actually stepping in and actually figuring out what they can do to contribute, right? And actually writing down information and really participating in the conversation itself. So it's not about telling people what they can do or telling them what to do. It's about everybody there and getting the feedback that you need to hear. We're getting close to the end. Industrial adaptive reuse is the third big leg of the stool. Got a lot of this stuff, these vacant industrial buildings across the city. At one level, I find them incredibly beautiful. At another level, we have to figure out what to do with them. 6.1 square miles of vacant industrial land, 4.3 square miles of vacant floor area of these industrial buildings. These are huge, huge numbers. They have unique characteristics, incredibly robust structural systems, big water, big power. You can do a lot in these buildings, and people do a lot in these buildings. we need to get them more activated. The portfolio is massive, and we're just scratching the surface. And so for us, when we look at projects like this is Packard, this is a portion of Packard, you know, we have to think also about the proximity of these pieces to neighborhoods around them. They're not just isolated out in some hinterland. People live by them and are often really impacted by them. And time matters. These places are kind of falling apart, but they are robust and they can do things. These are some shots that you know. This is a southern end of the Packard, which was taken down. This is all by stripping because they cut out the steel structure. And people live right there. This is very close to where I took that photo. And so to get there, we did some things like this, competition with parallel projections. We garnered, I think, a little over 200 entries from 30 countries to re-envision the Packard, and to do it in a way that wasn't kind of projecting this high-end kind of capital process of loft, residential, and all this stuff that is not only unlikely, but really inappropriate, given the amount of vacant housing stock the city has, could exacerbate problems. So what do we do differently here? How does it become part of a renewable energy production? How does it become part of a kind of arts development? How does it become part of a driving gallery that you can drive through the building on, right? That's what this whole loop is about. We just think at times when we push on things that are rather straightforward, we also need to step back and really think differently about what's possible. We also bring the community in then to see things. We all can look at the work and actually interject our own ideas. And that led us to work with the German Marshall Fund, and these are some diagrams we led up to it. These are some documents we developed to work with them and to garner funding. The German Marshall Fund for the United States has been our partner in this transatlantic exchange with folks in Europe that have developed projects to adaptively reutilize industrial spaces, and those in Detroit that are trying to do the same. This whole process has been operating over the last year and a half, and actually is gonna culminate later this February. This is Fernando Palazuelo, the gentleman that owns the Packard building now. And this is a group from GMF that's there. Many of you may recognize some of the people there. These are folks that came across. Part of a number of different projects over there to share with us what they learned. We've also been working with the University of Michigan in their Ross School of Business and others to actually develop new business models for these types of facilities to understand what's possible. So it's more than really because we can reconceptual design all the time, right? We can create all these renderings, but how does it actually work? So in this case, this was one of the projects that was put together, and it was undergirded by a big business plan. How do you do this? How do you have a limited capital threshold, and how do you make it operate over time? And how do you do that recognizing the history of these spaces? I mean, a lot of people say, well, wait a minute, the history matters. They do. These factories, many of them contributed to Detroit's war production. Over a third of the munitions and 100% of all war vehicles outside of tanks. It's also places of innovation. And they link back to other sites that we've been studying, right? This is the Fiat factory in Turin and how it was transformed over time. Through work with Renzo Piano and others. This may be the high-end luxury model of what's possible, and it may not be applicable to many, many parts of Detroit, but this might be. This is actually by our partners at Metabolic in Amsterdam. We were on this site in October. It's a really bottom-up process where they actually took over the property on a 10-year land lease from the city to come in and clean it up. They're using phyto and dendro remediation, a nasty former boatyard site in the north of Amsterdam. If you're curious, it's the last cool part of Amsterdam. And what they did was they ended up saying, well, the ground's rough. We can't really be on it. We got to clean it. And what we could do is float over these ubiquitous houseboats that are all across Amsterdam and actually put them on land. And that's what they did. And so all these little structures here are all houseboats sitting on the land. And this is in the process of developing, and they're shaping this walkway there, which is now complete. And the whole process there is intended to be to shape this circular economy. There's a little cafe on site, and so everything is grown there, or at least most everything now. They're trying to get to that full circular. The waste is recovered and is part of the growing process. It's a really amazing project, and it is highly transportable to places like Detroit with low capital and many of the places I was highlighting earlier in the presentation. It ends up being like the hotspot now in Amsterdam in the summer for parties. this is a cafe, and this is crazy. This is a really incredible project, and they're running a circular economy that actually puts money right back into the community, and the community helped them build it. There's, of course, other projects, big classic ones, like Dimitri's. This is the guy who's leading the Detroit-Berlin connection work, and this is an old power plant in Berlin. This is on the super sexy side. I wouldn't say this is top-down, but this is a little bit more robust. But this stuff can happen. We've got spaces like this, and we can do these things. In some cases, we've done them in the past. Many of us, perhaps in the room, have done these things illegally in the past. We could do them slightly legitimately. It's led to some other work that we've done for the Biennale. I'm just going to clip through this in kind of coordinating the responses here and all the sites. I'll just share a little bit of that with you. The responses aren't in yet, but this is part of it. We're helping to kind of coordinate that and get the work over, which is coming up soon. This is one of the sites along the cut. And then the last one I want to share with you is this, as we round the corner to the finish line. In some of the research I've been doing, really over the last, 5 years, and working with a lot of different groups around industry and former industrial buildings, it's led me to understand that we've got a little bit of another crisis on our hands in the United States. And the fact that our power system is changing. It's changing rapidly, and we don't really think about that often. And so it's led me to a number of different research initiatives, and it's tied back to those competitions I showed you, but it's also part of a studio I'm leading this term, a graduate design studio at University of Michigan called Power Prologue. It's the idea of what was past in power production could be really the future. Over the last, 25 years, the U.S. has closed down 200 coal-fired plants across the United States. That represents 40% of the total supply of 523 coal-fired plants. We have other power plants, of course, but these are just the coal ones. Many parts of the developed world are doing the same. Many places are actually far ahead of us. But as we do this, we have to realize that these plants, like this one in Michigan, actually sit on some of the most precious assets we have, right? Along, in the case of Michigan, our Great Lakes. They connect to urban areas in pretty big ways. They are part of the economies that are there. To disconnect these things is not just about turning off a dirty plant. It's about understanding how you actually recover this whole thing, the site, the access, everything. And for me, what do we do as architects in this space, right? How do we become part of this process? Because I can tell you right now, when they close, typically, they all get knocked down. They all go away, they all go to a landfill, and most of these sites get brownfielded. And that means no one has access, right? So this isn't just about some kind of building hugging activity to save buildings, but it's about thinking very carefully, very strategically about how we deal with these issues, but then actually provide people access to a natural resource, in many cases in neighborhoods where they didn't have any access at all. And this is certainly true in Detroit. If you think about the power grid in the United States and where these types of closures are concentrated, you just have to look at where the grid is today. It's not by chance that it's like this. These are the earlier industrialized areas and where you have higher populations. These are also then where we're seeing the power retirements, as the EPA calls them. The yellow ones are ripe for retirement, and you see them light up, and many of them are around us. So over the next really 4 years, we're going to have 9 sites closing in Michigan. They're all up on the map right now. That'll be 25 power generating units. A lot of power going offline, but a lot of power unneeded. Our economy changed, right? It's not the industrial economy it once was. Things are shifting, and other power production facilities, cleaner power facilities, are in place. Coal is not good, so I'm not lamenting the loss of these plants, but rather drawing attention to what their future could be. One of the areas I've been focused on, both as a consultant and as a design professional and studio instructor, is on DTE Energy Conner Creek plant and what might be possible there, and using that really as a prototype for how you deal with these other sites. So these are some of the other sites across Michigan that are going to close. This is what they look like today. What do you do here where you have high levels of toxicity, you have really precarious relationships with the environment around them, you have precarious relationships with the natural resources and the urbanized areas that are around them? Where do we intervene as architects? How do we work with policymakers to make sure that we hit these projects head on, not from the backside? And then how do we do that by looking at Conner Creek? This is a shot of one part of it, and understand how these sites could be completely recomposed, right? And how we take advantage of this, access and proximity to greater downtown. So this is a shot from the top of a part of Connor Creek. And we understand how we garner and drive in the investment that's happening along the riverfront, that site's in the pink or purple there. How do we tie that together to make a connection to the immediate surroundings, which are crazy? They're McMansions and marinas and junkyards and train sheds and high voltage facilities and a wastewater treatment plant and a yacht club. I mean, it's like Mad Libs kind of like spewed out on the urban landscape. And it's all there. And they're all, these spaces are a lot like this, right? They're kind of crazy. These are the spaces you put a bunch of crap you never really wanted to deal with. It just happens to be right on an international waterfront, right? Right at the throat of Lake St. Clair, a beautiful place to be. So what do you do here differently? How do you do it also in a way that doesn't just become the kind of procured space of the elite that wants to live on the waterfront, but rather a place that can actually employ Detroiters that need jobs, because that matters. And so how do you take really cool stuff like this and think differently about it, retaining the history of it over time, which I'll spare you the details. This is the only picture I could get of Connor Creek. So it wasn't just named Connor Creek for the heck of it. They named it after a creek that got decimated when they put the plant in. But this is not just, this happened in a lot of different places when you do this. And this actually flows through that wastewater treatment facility I showed you on the previous slide. So you know, as you see that kind of image that got changed and how the building stepped in, that's it. Up there you see all the smokestacks, that's the Seven Sisters as they went in. And this is all the land that we ended up filling in Detroit, because now the water line is out here that the Army Corps would track. So we've done some things here. How do we don't want to go back, but how do we take what we did and actually leverage it for some real benefit? These are some shots from within that are unbelievable. They have a boat club there. It's beautiful. And I think there's a lot of opportunities, and I really applaud DT for thinking about this. And there's cool spaces. There's a high-pressure turbine gallery, low-pressure turbine gallery. The one left, this is the seventh of the Seven Sisters. If you knock down that temporary wall on the right side of the slide, you're about 30 feet above the river looking right over it. Train shed, one of many beautiful buildings in the site. The acoustics in this are incredible. And then this shot, looking out of their screen house, out to this, these are water intake canals. This is why all these factories have to be on the water, because they draw this water in to cool them. Come on. It's gorgeous. So the precedents are there, right? I'll only show you a couple, but we know how this has happened before. This is Shumi's Parc de Lavalette. We've seen what we've seen in the Tate, right? And using these spaces, these are incredible spaces. I'm not suggesting that everything has to be, kind of high-end art and follies, but these are incredible spaces. And this is a space I recently visited. This is Zollverein in Germany, part of the UNESCO World Heritage Project, reclaiming part of the coking plant for a skating space. We can do things pretty powerfully here, and I think there's a lot of opportunities to do that in Detroit and other places. The bottom line is, with everything I've shown you, I just feel like we have opportunities as architects to really step into a space and do things that we might not have thought we could do in the past to make some differences. So thank you.
Thank you, Dan. I think it's a great lecture and showing a range of works from different scales and complexities. We can take a few questions from the audience. Yes, I'll run with the mic to you.
So thank you, Dan, for an amazing lecture. It's inspiring and unbelievably sobering as well. As you were talking, I was thinking about Zollverein, because I'm pretty familiar with the Ruhrgebiet and the work in the Ruhrgebiet. And you showed the last slide. I wanted to ask a question about that, but also something like Duisburg Nord. So I think architects intuitively love these kinds of spaces. I'm not sure the public does, and I'm just wondering, like, that book that you were involved with in terms of the differences between post-industrial cities in Europe and in the United States, not so much in terms of the economic structures or the government problems, but do you think that there are any issues in terms of just sensibility, like or can you isolate that? You know what I mean? Like just the aesthetic. I mean the American aesthetic.
Yeah, I mean I think that's real. I think there is a difference at some level. I would struggle to quantify it, but at a qualitative level, I'd say that it's there. And certainly, you think about there's a kind of the way that the European audience might covet some of these objects, and then on top of it, the direct way in which the Germans through the Eber-Emscher process shaped the Ruhr, both getting ahead of it, right, and planning ahead for this, and the longer structural change out of coal. That's a difference. I mean, in Detroit, you know, we're just trying to catch up with our problems, right? On top of it, though, I think you're right. I think there is probably a different approach here, and I think it's not one that's caught up in some kind of preoccupation with big, robust capital development, but rather maybe just a different sensibility. I do think, though, however, that if we gave people the opportunity to experience what some of these places are like, and we did take some people from Detroit with us there, and they were really blown away. You know, we were on Duisburg, the Landscape Park North, and walking along the elevated rail line, and it was awesome because this is mid-October, the vines had turned red, and I mean, I was like, I wanted to put that photo in here, I didn't get in. I mean, it was incredible, but it was this beautiful, quiet space, as you know, the large kind of remediation effort and all the ash piles was occurring. It was just gorgeous, and yeah, there were key parts of it that functioned and were rented and things like that. And we talked about the mixture of revenue and the dollars. At the end of the day, like this was real. It was actually a beautiful place to be in. And I feel like in some way, if we can try to exemplify that here at some level, we might be able to gain some interest and to use it as a passive space, as a park space. And I think in some ways, the work that was done at Seattle Gasworks Park is maybe an illustration that it's possible. Long-running project. But it could be possible, and I'm hopeful that it is, because I know that without it, in many cases, a lot of these structures are going to be taken down, and they will be forced into brownfield, you know, and it's just a loss at that point. So one of the things we're trying to explore right now is how we can think about this at Connors, but really think about it across all those other sites, and actually lay out something potentially to the US EPA to understand how they could use this as a kind of like pre-flight plan. When you come in, you're like, these are going to close. Here might be a game plan to follow. But I do understand your question. I we're about to find out how far apart we are. Yep.
Any other question?
Can you talk a little bit about, you'd mentioned kind of selecting particular parts of the city to start focusing on redevelopment efforts, considering Detroit's kind of emphasis on single family homes and how spread out they are. Can you talk a little bit about how you select those areas and then as they start to develop, how you judge their success?
Yeah, sure. I should back up by saying when I show a site like that too, it's important to note that we highlight and select the entire city for transformation, right? It's just, these are just different techniques. So yeah, one might be conventional development, one might be less, so on and so forth, right? And that's really important statement though. To your point though, I think what we look at is we see where, certainly there's market characteristics, there's building kind of infrastructure realities, there's underground infrastructure realities, bigger economic overlays, a whole host of things that we study on this. And understand where we can gain a foothold and stabilize, we know that there's a multiplying effect in the dollars that are invested there across the city. Particularly then if we can say, as this corridor is redeveloped, that when folks like bring in the D2D money that's being put through Motor City Match and so forth, that we can target that funding in a way that actually stabilizes that corridor there and does it in a way that makes sure that we're also bringing in Detroiters to own, occupy, and employ in that space. So it can't be just like, yeah, the space is functioning, it's cool, but no one locally benefits. Everybody's got to have a role in it. And we just went in on a recent MISHTA proposal to do that very same thing, but in a concentrated area to kind of test it, so that the new development methodology, the new RFQ and RFP process, particularly with public money, could be, okay, how are you going to do this, right? What's your capital stack, and you know how many units and all this? But on top of it, not just what's your engagement strategy, but what is your strategy to incorporate Detroiters in this process, both as owners and employees and so forth? That's key. So it's a differentiating process across the board, but the bottom line is, in the single family housing point, we have to get higher degrees of density in the city. We have to meet what the market wants, certainly, but the market right now is looking for more multi. In fact, it's the only market we can really, really track in the city, and even that has subsidy in the capital stack. The single family in many places won't pencil out.
Others? Filza?
First, I just wanted to say thank you for how you presented today and how you organized your presentation, just for the benefit, I think, of the students. For the rest of us in the room that are have had some years of experience, it's funny how every part of your life, every project, every interaction somehow prepares you to do the work that you're doing today. And I think that'll be true for the students that are sitting in this room as well. So I look forward to following their lives. My question, I guess, kind of two-part. One is, you've already talked about a lot of partnerships that you have, and with things like a recovery park and with Habitat that are Wayne, and so many others like that, and even Architecture 2030, which is part of the, so just what are some of the connections? How are they either, how are you informing them? How are they informing you? You know, what's the interaction together there?
Yeah, it's great. Thank you. I didn't cover any of those, and you saved me there for not mentioning those. They're all a little bit different than the examples you laid out. You know, I think 2030, it's a direct kind of correspondence back and forth at a kind of mutual level. I think in the case of Recovery Park, we've worked with them early on to identify the right strategy to land on the ground, how the space could be incorporated, how they could actually take on certain pieces of land, and what that impact would be in the local area, and particularly identifying a place. And they really took big steps in this, that where they knew they were taking property that would otherwise not really be part of the active conventional market, and so that was a little bit more of a direct, intimate relationship, and then a support. You know, we would support them in helping them identify resources and things, and bring in technical expertise. We helped to put together a charrette for them one time over at SEMCOG, where we brought in landscape designers so they could lay out a host of strategies on stormwater retention and how it connect to the hoop houses and stuff. Those are the kind of things we would do in that kind of relationship. But each one is a little bit different. Honestly, there's no real grand strategy, or at least no one's told me yet that there is. Yeah. Was that satisfactory? Was that it? Okay.
Hello. So first I want to say, like, I was a participant in the Packard Plan competition, and we were selected the top 10, and I was glad I saw myself in your lecture. And second, like, to a serious note, is that as I was looking all this project, and especially the precedents that you are showing from Europe and of these industrial spaces, when we see Europe in industrial spaces, those are concentrated mostly in populated areas and density or in the cities. And is it taken in this research any consideration about how we increase the density around these areas, or which will reflect in the shortening distance? And then, I mean, other than just developing that center, which might be turned into an amazing space, are we thinking about surrounding and how we can densify it?
Well, let me say this: we are thinking about the surroundings. We're thinking about the best things we can do in the surroundings to stabilize the entire city and to improve circumstances for everybody. Because one response would be, all right, that's it. We're tripling down on this site, we're gonna go into this building, we're gonna do this, and we're gonna run all this money in and around the area, we're gonna reinvent it, we're gonna build all these buildings, we're gonna do all this stuff. You turn around and like, oh, whoa, wait a minute, actually Rome was burning, I forgot, the city actually collapsed over here. We've done a lot of that in the past, right? We've gotten really excited about specific things and gone all in. What we wanna do is make sure that we're thinking about the entire city, right? Everywhere. And so to do that, it means, and some of these sites, right, these whether it's Packard or otherwise, think about, okay, what's happening there? What are the kind of near, medium, long-term uses for it? That and sometimes these aren't sexy. You know, I didn't show you this, but one of the things that we've been thinking about on the Packard, it's just massive, right? There's certain program elements you can have in it, and right now the northernmost part is occupied by Display Group, but everything else is empty and in some cases falling down. How do you come in to actually generate some positive cash flow just to work to stabilize it, right? We thought at one level, this could be a pumped hydro power generation facility. You have really robust structure. You could have photovoltaics in a field next door because all of it's open. You use those photovoltaics to power water up, hold it at elevation. This is essentially how TVA powers Appalachia, right? You take water up at elevation, and when you need the power, this is the most effective and efficient way to store power rather than a battery. Hold it, and then you want it, you just run downhill, and you run it through micro turbines, and they produce power. That could produce community power all around there, and there could be a ratepayer return on that over time. That's a stabilization strategy. That could actually begin to work, but it's not something that typically falls within a conventional pro forma, right? But we think it's something that we really do need to look at. In the case of what you do around there, it really matters about what's happening there and what the neighborhood wants. You know, what they want to get to. And in some cases, the aspiration may have a great deal of distance from what you can really do that moment, but you can then guide a longer-term strategy toward it, taking steps. But what we can't do is have some of the conversations I know we've had in the past in the city, which work to kind of placate folks to say, yes, of course, we'll do this. In some cases, you do it to the detriment of many others, or where you completely deny any of it and just walk away. We have to find a way to work through it and figure out what's possible and have kind of shared authorship in that. But these things are going to take time. I mean, I don't know that any of us are going to be here when some of these things are realized. It takes a long, long time, and we have to think differently about the process.
Any other questions? Okay. In the shortest route.
You had mentioned sort of the your talk was largely about cities, but you sort of mentioned non-urban areas in passing in the way that cities in Africa and Asia are sort of growing to include surrounding villages, and also how rural populations are migrating to cities. And you talked about the positives and the negatives of people living in cities in terms of the opportunities, in terms of GDP and innovation, and then the flip side of that in terms of pollution and greenhouse gases and other things. So I was just wondering where you see the relationship between the urban and rural, and is there, and what can cities do to benefit their hinterlands, I mean, if that's still a valid term.
It's a great point. I think I think while it's important, while I showed the metabolic hockey stick diagrams up there that were showing all these things go up, and then the next thing showing like, yeah, cities have, oh, you moved. I'm like, where did you go? The next thing it's like, well, yeah, and the cities contribute to this and this, but the mixed message in all that is that while they contribute to that high percentage that save greenhouse gases and so forth, the reality is that it could be far, far worse if there was if this was much more massive sprawl than what we see today. And I think that's something we do want to manage. I think from what we understand outside of a, you know, smart growth kind of thing, I'm not suggesting that we do have to think strategically about this. And we have to recognize that agglomerating economies do function in places of higher density. We can actually foster those economic relationships that we need, quite honestly, that we lack in Detroit right now because we've not had it so long. We're kind of jump-starting the car to get there right now. But as we go forward, we need to support that. We need to recognize that density matters, and that density actually keeps us also from making a mess in all of these other places. We've not managed that at all. It's a big conversation that could happen here around the long-term, you know, planning in the United States, particularly coming out of the Eisenhower administration and the Federal Highway. You know, we won't go there, but we can recover some of what we've lost in the United States and some of that decision-making. We have to think more strategically about it. A place like Detroit in the Metro Detroit region, we have to think regionally about what's responsible here, right, for everybody. it's not responsible for us to sprawl everywhere. We're gonna have challenges. And it's not just that we take over and put concrete everywhere, but we're gonna actually stifle economies when we do it. And we're gonna limit opportunity for folks, especially when 20% of Detroiters don't have access to a private car, and Detroit has the highest job sprawl rate, right? This is a big problem. To the point, though, in, say, South Asia or East Asia, let's just say it's particularly South Asia, I think from what I can tell, and I'm not the expert here, I kind of look at the stuff and figure out how to convey it. What I'm seeing is that there's a kind of predisposition to start to actually claim new spaces for urbanized areas rather quickly. And as it's happening, what the World Bank has indicated, that these things are happening in their language in hidden and messy ways. And what that means is that you don't have all the government programs in place, because sometimes they don't know that these areas have been incorporated the way they have. And they're messy in that the actual distribution of land and the ownership is all messed up. And then lastly, the infrastructure can't come in place to support people. And that infrastructure really, really makes people struggle. That South Asia is big on this, where they're having significant challenges than having folks actually be part of the workforce so the actual GDP over population is coming down rapidly. But if you look at what we were seeing in sub-Saharan Africa, it's really worse. And where, you know, I think that one stat we were looking at was well over 70% of the workforce in a certain area was traveling by foot over a great distance and through some really substantial challenges that weren't just natural. So if we don't think about that step ahead, we're just gonna miss all these opportunities. I think we're gonna run out of time to recover. Right, because right now we can talk about recovery in some of these places. Okay, replan it, correct this, do that. There's gonna come a point where we're just not gonna have that opportunity. And so that kind of gives me some concern. I think right now there is a chance to get there, and I think we have to work really, really hard with global partners to do it. But it's, from what I can tell at least in the work that we do, it's very tough, yeah.
Anybody else? Any last questions? Okay, so thank you, Dan, very much for a provocative lecture. Thank you all. Good night.